the sick above your own. To all those who are in the front lines of this pandemic, thank you.
Violence returns to the streets of Hong Kong. The UN chief also urging world leaders to take the lead in the fight against climate change.
Carmina Constantine bringing you the latest news Monday to Friday at 12 noon on Dateline Philippines. Take the lead even when on the go. Keep abreast of the latest news and information with the ABS-CBN News app. Receive news alerts, audio stream DZMM, and customize your news feed. All these and more with the ABS-CBN News app. Download the ABS-CBN News app now, available on Google Play Store and the App Store.
The world has been forever changed. The period we have lived through has seen a radical shift in relationships, in values, in our own memories. But even as the world struggles to redefine itself, our traditional artists have held on to that which is most valuable to them. The work they do, the skills they have nurtured, now passed on to young members of their communities. Legacies that must find their place in the changed world we all live in.
In this episode, we visit two local artisans to see how a bespoke pair of shoes and a tailored suit can be crafted in time for when we return to our normal work and social routines. Plus, we take a look at the most effective way to clean, repair, and organize your travel wardrobe and winter wear and have them ready for your travels ahead.
Magandang gabi, bayan.
Stay updated with the daily issues and current events.
Tulad po ng aming pinangako, nagbabalik ang ating TV Patrol
with the Philippines' leading local evening newscast. The national stories presented to you by the country's trusted anchors and reporters. TV Patrol. Watch it weeknights here on the ABS-CBN News Channel.
Doesn't have her seatbelt on.
Okay, okay. Gloria, it's back to Gloria.
The latest news and information you get on radio, TV, and the internet are now in the ABS-CBN Radio Service app. Stream anytime, anywhere with BZMM Radyo Patrol. Plus different podcast content from ABS-CBN News and the ABS-CBN News Channel. Download the ABS-CBN Radio Service app now. Available on Google Play Store and Apple App Store.
No school, no problem.
Some parents are now considering switching to the alternative way of education, homeschooling.
Education is the single biggest barrier to economic and social mobility.
How exactly are you providing transformational education to children?
So what we decided to do was to leverage the world's best video-based technologies as well as analytical tools to try and make it possible to deliver to almost every child in the country.
What's the first thing we need to do? So I think it's very good first to prepare ourselves for this, not to dive and delve and get ourselves into it without preparing ourselves as parents and parent teachers.
Does homeschool entail that the parent teach every subject there is?
The parent is more of a facilitator of learning rather than the teacher. Okay. They don't have to know everything and teach everything because of technology.
Education has its way of finding a way back.
I wouldn't say that it is better, but clearly I'm in this space because I think that there are a lot of big gains.
184 congressmen.
After the fact, we get to see things more clearly.
Do you stand by your vote, and are you proud of that vote?
Of course, you have to stand with what your decision is.
Is this something that the House should be proud of, rejecting the application for a new franchise by ABS-CBN?
Well, it's the decision of Congress.
Inside any specific
After the
journal,
fact, we know who's telling the truth.
Sana kung mayroon kayo mga crews dito.
Alam niya naman yung nangyari, Governor, di ba? You were asking, sana may crew dyan. I suppose you were referring to ABS-CBN. Hindi binigay yung franchise eh. So, naisara yung regional station. So, paano makakover yung nangyayari dyan? What clinched the speakership
After the fact,
for
with Christian Esguerra. Weeknights at 8 p.m. only on ANC. This is the Philippines.
Buhay!
We are ANC. The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
It's Tuesday, May 18 in Manila. I'm Karen Davila giving you the head start for the day. Our guests for Hot Coffee today, we have Senator Francis Pangilinan as we talk about President Duterte's briefing last night about the West Philippine Sea and also pork prices and COVID-19 response. And later on, we have House Senior Citizens Panel Chair Rodolfo Ordanez on his House resolution seeking government agencies to help the Philippine General Hospital. First, the headlines. Today's big stories, former Defense Minister and Senate President Juan Ponce Enrile says President Duterte is doing the right thing in pushing for a more diplomatic approach in the West Philippine Sea issue against China. Local chief executives in the Philippines bumped to second priority for COVID-19 vaccinations. And the World Health Organization says the world has now reached a situation of vaccine apartheid. A former Philippine defense minister and a longtime politician is backing President Duterte's moves on the West Philippine Sea issue against China. In President Rodrigo Duterte's Talk to the People Monday night, Juan Ponce Enrile, the country's defense chief during the Marcos years and former Senate president, praised the chief executive for his friendly approach despite China's aggression. The 97-year-old also advised Duterte to ignore his critics.
Mr. President, you are answerable only to history for your foreign policy.
Yes, sir.
Only history will judge you. And I think that history will judge you very well. If I were in your place, I would have done the same thing. We have no choice except to negotiate with China. Assuming there's no dispute about our right over exclusive economic exploitation of our West Philippine Sea asset, still we need foreign money to make it a source of wealth for the country. Now, our choice at that point will be either go to Europe and get technology and capital to explore the energy resources of our economic zone in West Philippine Sea, or deal directly with China. China is one of the best energy explorer now.
Enrile, however, disagreed with Duterte, who again downplayed the country's arbitral victory against China, calling it meaningless. Enrile said the victory is not a waste, but he also admitted it would be pointless to bring up the issue with the United Nations.
Palagay ko nakarehistro yung decision na yun sa record ng UN. Alam nila yun. Ang karapatan natin nanggaling din sa UN Convention of the Law of the Sea. Kaya ano pang kailangan resolusyon ng ng UN para malunasan yung sigalot na yan para sa atin. Palagay ko, kahit na may resolusyon ng UN, eh hindi naman maipapatupad ng UN yung resolusyon nila. Wala silang police force eh. Wala namang world government na kagaya ng istruktura natin sa ating bansa.
Former Senate President Enrile also questioning America's role in the West Philippine Sea dispute between the Philippines and China. He believes the U.S. was partly to blame when the Philippines supposedly lost its hold in Scarborough Shoal. Back then, Washington tried to mediate between the two sides when Manila and Beijing had a standoff in the area nearly a decade ago. Enrile now saying the Philippines can't really rely on the United States despite a standing defense treaty.
Ang impression ko bagay, parang ginamit lang tayo doon sa bagay na yun. Hanggang ngayon, hindi ko masagot kung bakit yung mediator natin ay hindi tayo tinulungan para tumupad naman ang China para doon sa kasunduan na umatras sila. Kaya ngayon, sila ang nakapwesto doon. Kung aasa tayo sa tulong ng Amerika, lalo na ngayon, magulo sila sa Amerika. At marami silang problema, nandiyan ang problema sa Gaza. Palagay ko, kahit napupunta tayo sa UN, mag-iisyo ng resolusyon ang UN, eh aasahan ng UN na magpapairal nun eh, Amerika din, o yung mga kakayahan. At palagay ko, sa panahon na ito, walang bansa na pwedeng makaya ang China. Kaya tama yung posture ninyo na kausapin ang China dito sa bagay na ito. Huwag gagamitin ng emosyon at init ng ulo.
Enrile also took a swipe at former Senator Antonio Trillanes, who was tapped by then-President Noynoy Aquino for back-channel talks with Beijing. The former Senate President says Trillanes' actions at that time were questionable.
Binigyan ako ng sulat ni Ambassador Brady natin sa China na nagre-reklamo na itong si Trillanes ay binabypass siya. Yung pala, si Trillanes ay pasok at labas sa China na tila hindi na dumadaan sa immigration dahil inuutosan yata siya ni Presidente Aquino. Kaya sinabihan ko sila na dapat huwag natin gawin yun sapagkat bansa ang nauukol dito.
All right, joining us now on Hot Copy, we have Senator Francis Kiko Pangilinan, who we really invited on the program, setting the record straight, Senator, who agreed for the issue on rice and pork tariffs. Senator Kiko, good morning to you, sir.
Yes, good morning, Karen. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but I can't see you.
There you
are. There, you're back.
There. Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, I need to get your reaction first because a lot of people were surprised by last night's the cabinet meeting, so to speak. It was the president's Monday night address. What do you make of former Senate President Enrile's advice that, number one, the president should ignore his critics when it comes to the West Philippine Sea dispute, and we should take a friendly stance towards China, and that the president is doing the right thing?
Well, of course, we disagree. Well, okay lang naman, tama naman. We should have a friendly, negotiated, diplomatic approach. And no one will dispute that. Pero iba naman yung usapan ng subservience at surrender. Mabuti pa nga ang Vietnam at Indonesia tumatayo at naninindigan kontra sa panghihimasok ng China. Hindi ba? tayo, inuuna natin yung utang na loob sa China, pero yung mga kapakanan ng ating mga mangingisda, hindi natin ipinagtatanggol. Hindi tama yun. There's one thing, it's one thing to be friendly and diplomatic. It's another thing to be subservient and tikumambibig o nananahimik o nagsusunod-sunuran. China is the aggressor here. Pero bakit ang binabatikos eh US? China is occupying key areas in our exclusive economic zone. We are talking of about 300,000 or 500,000 square kilometers that are now being threatened. Vietnam and Indonesia have shown the way na hindi naman kinakailangan girahin, pero pwedeng manindigan at tiyakin na ang sinasabi nila, ang atin ay atin at hindi natin ito isusuko kanino man. And yun ang dapat natin posisyon.
What do you make of... You have retired Senior Associate Justice Antonio Carpio, also a group of lawyers now, asking the president to retract his statements saying the arbitral win was meaningless and China was in possession of the West Philippine Sea. Should the president retract his statement, Senator?
Well, that's up to the president. Whether he will, of course, is another question altogether. But we welcome these efforts to be able to clarify yung issue, no? So para nalalaman ng ating mga kababayan. So the position taken by retired Justice Carpio is a welcome opportunity, no, to further deepen yung ating awareness nitong issue laban sa China at sa pagprotekta ng ating soberenya at ang ating exclusive economic zone.
Mm-mm. Okay. Now, the issue, of course, is sovereignty and food security. At one point during the time of former President Aquino, you were former presidential advisor on food security. Before we move on to rice and pork, how will this affect food security if the West Philippine Sea issue is not handled correctly?
Well, right now, in our consultations with our fisher folk organizations, dati malaya silang nakakapagpangisda dyan sa mga lugar na yan. At ang kita nila sa isang labas, 4,000 pesos. Mahina ang 4,000 pesos habang sila. Ngayon, tinataboy sila. So bagsak talaga ang kanilang kita dyan sa karagatan, sa lugar na in dispute. And ang record ay sinasabi about 170,000 metric tons of fish are being consumed or caught every day. Every day. That is food security. Ang pinakamurang source ng protina para sa ating mga kababayan ay isda. At napakahalaga ng protina para manatiling malusog ang ating mga kababayan. Tapos ang nangyayari, tinataboy ang mga mangingisda natin. Ngunit hindi natin ipinaglalaban at hindi ito tama. Kaya tama, matuto tayo sa Vietnam, matuto tayo sa Indonesia. Naninindigan sila kontra sa panghihimasok ng China. At alam nyo ba, mas malaki pa ang investment ng China sa Vietnam in terms of direct investments ng Chinese money kumpara dito sa ating bansa. So hindi ibig sabihin kapag ikaw is nagsusunod-sunuran, iuunahin ka o bibigyan ka ng importansya. In fact, ang mga nagsusunod-sunuran, yun ang unang binabaliwala. Kaya dapat tayo naninindigan para maprotektahan natin ang ating mga isda, ang ating pagkain, at ang ating teritoryo at exclusive economic zone.
Okay, just quickly on this, Senator Kiko, should we already start drilling oil, or at the very least, I know that in the beginning there was it was halted in terms of finding out which areas of the West Philippine Sea we can source for power. But then President Duterte mentioned last night that Xi Jinping told him, if you do that, there will be trouble. I wanted you to react on that before we leave this subject.
Well, Vietnam has taken a position on this issue with respect to their claims, Indonesia, and there has been no war.
Yeah.
And so that issue of trouble war, I doubt very much. No, war is parang tinatakot tayo para hindi tayo kumilos. Eh, ba't tayo magpapatakot?
Mm-hmm.
Tapos ang kinin nila yung 300,000 square kilometers. That's about the size of the entire land mass of the Philippines. 300,000 plus square kilometers. Mm-hmm. We will not speak up. We will keep quiet and we will say, paano tayo magkakaroon ng utang na loob sa China na inaagaw yung ating exclusive economic zone? Hindi tama.
Okay. All right. Now, from fish as food security in the West Philippine Sea, let's talk about rice and pork. Let's start first with rice. You said there will be a double whammy effect with the president's executive order lowering rice tariffs. Expound on this, Senator.
Well, actually, three issues. No. Number one, mukhang hindi na naman nakonsulta yung sektor ng industriya ng bigas. No. Ang Federation of Free Farmers, sinasabing walang konsultasyon. Number two, rice inflation is minus 0.3. Ibig sabihin,
hindi tumataas.
Yes. In fact, bumababa ang presyo ng bigas.
Mm-mm.
Which means, sufficient yung supply.
Mm-mm.
So bakit natin bibigyan ng prioridad yung mag-import? Mm-hmm. You import precisely because supply is short or kulang. Pero hindi naman kulang yung supply.
Mm-hmm.
So bakit binaba from 50 to 35 and 40 to 35? Sino ang makikinabang dito? Ang mga importer. Pangatlo, mababawasan yung korekta ng tarifa. Ang tarifa, pupunta dapat yan, yung excess ng 10 billion pupunta sa ating rice farmers at yung Rice Competitiveness Enhancement Fund. Di mababawasan yun. In fact, hindi double whammy. Di ba? Makikipagkompetensya na naman ang ating local rice farmers, imported na bigas, at the time when we don't have a shortage. In fact, there is minus 0.3% inflation.
Hmm.
So what is this for?
Uh-oh. What do you think is the motive behind this or the intention, Senator Kiko, considering Malacanang defended the decision and said they just followed the recommendations of NEDA, and they said it's to make sure that there will be a diversified source of market.
Well,
in other words, yes, go ahead, go ahead.
Yes, diversified because now imports from Pakistan, China, yung most favored nation na organ, kasi dalawa yan, no? Yung ASEAN, mas mababa yung tarifa kasi nga we are one community sa ASEAN, and then outside ASEAN mas mataas ang tarifa.
Mm-hmm.
So ang ginawa nila, ginawa nilang mababa pareho, whether ASEAN or most favored nation. Ang kasama doon China, Pakistan at India.
Mm-hmm.
So na right now pwede naman mag-import dito sa mga bansa na ito. Ang ginawa nila, ginawa na nilang mas mura yung bayad ng tarifa. So importers at yung mga Chinese at Pakistani and Indian exporters, yan ang binibigyan ng pabor.
Mm-hmm.
Dito. Kaya hindi ko maintindihan, importers na naman ang binigyan ng priority. Mabuti sana kung tumataas ang presyo ng bigas at kulang ang supply. Pati na rin ng Department of Agriculture sinasabing hindi kulang ang supply. So ito'y hindi ko naiintindihan saan nang gagaling itong pagbaba ng tarifa, pati sa bigas. Parang sinabay eh. Tapos wala pang consultation.
Okay.
Yun ang problema Binigla na naman ang industriya. Diyan magkakaroon ng dagdag na agam-agam sa nasabing sektor.
Now, can the president lower tariffs before Congress resumes?
Yes. And what we're preparing to do is file a joint resolution to withdraw that reduction of the tariff.
Uh-oh.
Whether we will get support or not is another question altogether. But that is also a power of Congress.
Mm-hmm.
Imposing taxes is really, a power of the legislative branch.
Mm-hmm.
And in exceptions, given certain situations, the president is empowered. We delegate that power to the president,
mm-hmm.
but only for a short period while we are not in recess. While we are not in session. And now that we're back in session, there's another question. Was it published? If it was published, when will it take effect?
Yes.
And therefore, whether or not it is effective, of course, is something that we'd like to clarify.
But, And what about the timing of it? Because some have questioned the timing, that it was done precisely before Congress resumed.
Well, that was debated. That was discussed sa ating sa Senate, no? And in fact, yun na nga, pati yung support. No, the letter was forwarded to us the last day of our session.
Yes.
The law says that unless we act on it within 15 days from the time that we receive the notice, then it becomes effective. Ang problema dito, and the law says if we do not act, it's not a question of whether we could act, whether we acted or not. It's a question of we could not act because we were on recess, and that is not the intention of the law. Mm-mm.
Senator Kiko, are you seeing possible interests in this particular decision? Clearly, you have importers that stand to benefit, exporters from other countries that stand to benefit, but within the country, you have importers.
I don't think this rice tarification, you know, it's not as simple as that, but merong mga sumasakay. Mm-mm. Merong mga nakikinabang, merong mga nag-uudyok. Dahil we cannot take the rice tarification endorsement alone, in isolation. Kasabay yan ng pork eh. In fact, yung pork mas matindi dahil talagang, kumbaga, binukas na yung intention, malunod na tayo sa frozen pork. Which is precisely something that the Senate stood up against. And thankfully, a compromise was met. From 404,000 metric tons, naging 254,000 metric tons. And from a 5 and 10% tariff reduction, meaning reduction to 5 and 10%, naging 15% and 20%. So nagkaroon ng compromise. But precisely, it was the vigilance of the Senate, the criticisms made by the Senate, and the concerns of the sector that made this possible.
Do you believe, Senator Kiko, that it may have the same effect again? Clearly, when the Senate made its sentiments known regarding the pork tarification and the MAV, the president adjusted his first decision. Do you believe it can happen again?
Well, we can only try. No, we will see. Kokonti lang na tumawag sa akin, dalawa pa lang ang tumatawag dahil nabigla nga sila eh.
Okay.
So nice kong makausap din ang sektor ng the rice industry, no, the rice sector, the rice farmers. Mm-mm. And see ano ang pwede nating gawin dito sa pagbaba ng taripa ng imported na bigas.
Okay. Very quickly, let's move on to pork. I spoke with Department of Agriculture Secretary William Dar, and the president's declaration of a state of calamity, he says, will make a difference in the support for the industry. What should be prioritized, Senator, quickly?
Tatlo. Yung indemnification sa mga magbababoy dahil close to 100 billion pesos worth of damages na ang naranasan ng hog industry. This will really affect our local hog industry and strategically yung ating source of pork, di ba? Pangalawa, so indemnification, bigyan sila ng suporta. Pangalawa, itong biosafety protocols.
Yes.
Kinakailangan i-fast track yung pagmamonitor ng labas-pasok ng frozen meat. This should be a priority because if we are not able to monitor the entry of the quality of meat from the imports, chances are makakalusot na naman itong African swine fever dahil kahit sa frozen pork, pwedeng namanatiling buhay itong swine fever. Pangatlo, itong cash for work para sa ating mga magbababoy at itong repopulation. Ibig sabihin, paramihin ulit dahil 3 million heads na ang pinapatay para hindi na kumalat itong swine fever. So all these three, nung wala pa yung state of calamity declaration, which we pushed since February, having been food security secretary, we did that for pest management infestation sa Kokolisap, and we were able to address the problem within 6 months. Nadagdagan ng pondo. With this state of calamity declaration, Ngayon, madadagdagan yung pondo ng DA. They can now source funds from the calamity fund of the national government. Without this executive order declaring state of calamity, kulang ng 6 billion yung 2021 African swine fever intervention ng DA. So they can now source more funds and focus on ensuring na ma-repopulate, di ba? Magkaroon ng biosafety protocols and most importantly, yung suporta sa local hog industry, yung indemnification ng kanilang mga losses.
Oo. And I wanted to ask you clearly for the ASF to have gotten in the country, the Department of Agriculture admits that we need to improve border inspection. So apparently, parang mano-mano pa lang yung ating border inspection, Senator.
That is right. In fact, when I was Food Security Secretary, challenged na yan sa Bureau of Plant Industries. Because nung yung coco lisap infestation, which destroyed over 2 million coconut trees in Calabar Zone, yung kanilang scientific assessment was that it came from imported plants.
Yes. So why can't we prioritize on this, Senator?
And this is part of the reason why we had the committee of on agriculture hearing and then the committee of the whole hearing, because may budget na for these biosafety protocols and border border controls. And they're now putting together precisely itong border control in infrastructure in place. Dapat sana mas maaga. Okay. But this should be the lesson learned. You know, billions have been lost precisely exactly because of our porous borders. Mm-hmm. So if we are to spend 2-3 billion to ensure stronger border patrols, then we could have saved, and we will in the future save 100+ billion or more worth of damages precisely because we're able to protect our borders.
Okay, a few more issues. I hope you we get to this quickly. I know that the Senate will be adding more session days to approve priority measures. And what do you believe, what is your priority measure that you want to make sure is approved?
Well, Senator Ralph Recto has a Bayanihan 3 measure, and we would like to support that. How do we provide more stimulus for our economy? Sabi nga nila, if 2020 was bad for the economy, 2021 is worse. Because one, we have not effectively managed the spread of the disease. Two, there are new variants. Three, our vaccine rollout remains
slow,
spotty, and hopefully this will improve. But fourth, yung mga natabing savings ng ating mga kababayan noong 2020, ubus na. So gutom, mas matindi ang gutom ngayon. That's why the stimulus package, I think, should be followed through. Of course, there are other laws. Itong retail trade law, liberalization, kasama yan para pasiglahin ang ating ekonomiya given nga itong pagbagsak nito. And they're also working on the BARM postponement of the elections kasi dapat 2022 magkaroon na ng BARM elections after yung interim set of officials. Pero dahil sa COVID, hindi na saayos yung ilang pinakailangan ponduhan. Mm-mm. So they're saying we need to postpone the BARM elections. We support that too. And so Bayanihan 3 for me is the priority.
Yes.
Although unfortunately, mukhang iba-iba ang sinasabi ng executive department. The Department of Trade wants additional funding. But it seems the body language is, where do we get the funds?
Yes.
And that's the challenge.
Okay. And just very quickly, are you also running the Senate version of Senator Recto is also at 405 billion? Is it the same, roughly?
Yes. But I think sa House, it's 485 billion. So we will have to figure out. But the important thing is we have to put money in the pockets of our people so that they can spend and so that they can eat. And address these challenges of hunger. It's real, especially in urban centers like Metro Manila.
Okay. Senator, just two more questions very quickly. Vaccination, you have your colleagues already calling for the government to bump up the A4 already, right now? Because right now we're vaccinating A1 to A3 and it's been slow. You have elderlies that are hesitant, some that don't want to get vaccinated, but you have a lot of the economic frontliners that are frankly, you know, raring to get vaccinated so they can go back to work, but then they're not yet in the A4. So what is your stand on this?
We have had more lessons learned, no? And more data coming in na yung mga nagtatrabaho, sila rin ang nag-spread kasi sila lumalabas eh. At sila rin ang so kinakailangan talagang i-review itong patakaran tungkol doon sa mga...
Should we re-strategize? Kasi may nagsasabing iba, kung sino na gusto magpabakuna, pabakunahan nyo na at the end of the day. At the end of the day, to achieve herd immunity is you need to get people vaccinated.
Yes, yes. In fact, the data, for example, sa Italy, 13.7 million have been vaccinated. But this is Pfizer, AstraZeneca, and Moderna. And 80% ang reduction ng infections.
Uh-oh.
90% ang reduction ng hospitalizations. Mm-hmm. And 95% ang reduction ng deaths.
Uh-oh. So should we bump up A4 already, Senator?
I think so. But at the same time, we have to make sure na mabilis yung rollout. Mm-hmm. Kasi isang linggo at 30,000 eh. Dapat yan, 500,000 a day.
Yes.
And that's why I will go back to the issue of we need to get local governments mobilized and the private sector mobilized. Okay. Kung ang DOH lang ang nakamobilize dito, eh hindi uubra. We really need the army on the ground, the infantry on the ground, and that will be provided for by the private sector together with the LGUs.
Okay. All right. My last question is about the 2022 elections. I know that the Liberal Party is eyeing to recruit 75,000 new members and volunteers, but more than that is, did you know that Senator Antonio Trillanes, Senator Antonio Trillanes wanted to run for president? That particular announcement that Vice President Lenny Robredo was eyeing for a local post.
Well, that has since been clarified.
No? Yes, she clarified it.
She has not made a decision. Yes. And therefore, eyeing that gubernatorial or local post is inaccurate. And number two, Senator Sani has said that if VP Lenny decides, then he will step aside. So I think marami pang mangyayari, kaya pwede nating abangan. Pero I think ang dapat mangyari ngayon sa halip na pag-usapan sino bang mga kandidato, we can do that maybe 2-3 months from now. Pag-usapan natin paano magparehistro pa ng mas marami.
It's very true.
Because 73 million ang sinabi ng PSA at COMELEC na eligible voters for 2022. Yeah. But only 58 million are registered. So that's about a whopping 15 million citizens who are not registered. Yeah. Almost 16 million, in fact. And we know 16 million is a magic number. Mm-hmm. And that's why, let's not put the cart before the horse.
Yeah.
Let's get the voters registered. Itong, lalo na yung mga kabataan, maraming hindi rehistrado.
Okay.
Hopefully, with the support of the COMELEC, mas marami tayong mapaparehistro dun sa 16 million na hindi rehistrado. Sabi nila, anong gagawin ko?
Okay. Isang
utulong ako. Ay, ang problema nun, ang dami nang sabi ng ganun, kaya 16 million na.
All right.
Rehistrado. So dapat baguhin natin yan.
On that note, Senator Francis Kiko Pangilinan, what a pleasure it is to speak with you this morning. Thank you
very
much.
Ano ang sinasabi ng mga baboy ngayon? Anong nararamdaman nila?
Is this a joke?
Yes.
But go ahead, sir. Ano?
Nararamdaman nila, pig hati.
On that note, we're going to go on a quick break. Thank you so much.
Maraming salamat.
For your time this morning.
Good morning.
Stay strong.
Good morning.
Stay well, Senator Kiko Pangilinan. Thank you. When we return, House Senior Citizens Panel Chair Rodolfo Ordanez will be joining us on Get Start.
The Tingnan nyo, oh, puti ito.
Mas puti ito.
Mas puti.
For Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks. For Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks. For Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having
Welcome back to Head Start. More cases of highly transmissible COVID variants are detected in the Philippines. Rafael Bosano explains.
The Philippine Health Department is closely monitoring the condition of four Filipinos infected with a COVID-19 variant first detected in India. It says one of the patients is still intubated, while three others continue to rely on oxygen support. The Philippines has so far detected 12 cases of the India COVID-19 variant. Nine were seafarers aboard the MV Athens. Two traveled from Belgium through a connecting flight from the United Arab Emirates, while another one came from Oman.
Yung nine na MV Athens crew, they were immediately isolated. Actually, itong barko na to, hindi natin talaga pinapayagan dumaong. Ayaw natin payagan, kaya lang for humanitarian reasons, ay pinayagan na rin natin dahil nagsabi na sila na may dalawa ng severe at nahirapang huminga doon sa cargo ship.
The Octa Research Group says while the Indian variant has entered the country, they see no indication of it being widespread.
So, ang inaasahan natin, dahil pumasok yung mga kaso ng Indian variant, nung ECQ at MECQ, baka hindi masyadong kumalat ito. Baka may mga konti lang nakawaan. Yan ang inaasahan natin. Kasi kung kakalat yan, makikita natin yan. Itataas yung bilang ng kaso.
David adds cases in the NCR, the country's epicenter for COVID-19, continues to decrease. In the last 7 days, average daily cases have gone down to 1,479. And while the reproduction number is only at 0.57, the region's positivity rate is 11%. That's still higher than the World Health Organization's benchmark of 5%. On Monday, the Philippines logged a little less than 6,000 new infections. There were 6,602 new recoveries and 72 deaths. It's not only the number of infections that's seeing improvement. Officials say overall healthcare utilization at the capital region is now lower at 48%. These include ICU, isolation and ward beds.
We hope to see that the intensive care unit will really go down to the low risk category, that's below 60%. And the total HCUR also would be low risk. And that's that would mean that we have a robust kind of health system that we're capable of handling any kind of surge if you're in a low risk.
Meanwhile, the health department has detected nine carriers of the B.1.1.7 variant first found in the United Kingdom. In Cagayan Valley, Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergeres says this might explain why cases are increasing in Tuguegarao. Studies earlier showed that the UK variant had a reproduction rate 1.35 times higher than normal coronavirus variants. But the DOH says COVID-19 vaccines have been deployed to the region and their utilization rate is also high. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Local chief executives in the Philippines are bumped up from fourth to second priority for COVID vaccinations. They were previously grouped together with essential workers who have yet to receive their COVID shots. Vivian Gulia reports.
Mayors and governors have moved up in the country's COVID-19 vaccine priority list. The IATF has included them in the A1.5 priority group, an upgrade from being under the fourth priority group or A4.
Kasi po ang mga mayor at gobernador ang nagpapatupad po ng prevention, detection, isolation, treatment, and rehabilitation, a cornerstone of our COVID program. They may not be doctors, but they are equally frontliners.
A senator and some local governments are calling on the IATF to immediately open the COVID vaccination to the A4 priority group, which covers essential workers.
Kung gusto ko nating maabot yung herd immunity by end of the year, no, which is 50 million, wag na natin antayin na magbago pa yung isip nitong mga seniors at yung iba pang may comorbidity. I-akyat na natin kaagad yung A4. And then nakikita ko siguro mga by June pwede na mag-general, as early as June pwede na mag-general public.
This comes after some Metro Manila cities observed vaccine hesitancy among senior citizens, which are part of the second priority group. In Valenzuela City, only 15% of residents registered online to get vaccinated against COVID.
It's quite worrisome kasi kung iisipin mo kung excited ang mga tao magpabakuna, sana lumobo ka agad yung numero. So it could be one, hesitant sila. Two, nandun sila sa manood muna ako sa epekto ng mga nagpabakuna ngayon. Or three, minsan meron tayong ugali na gusto natin last minute.
In Avota City, only around 30% of the elderly population registered to get jabbed, even though they were given the opportunity to pick their preferred brand and schedule.
Hindi po sila dapat mag-hesitate kasi nga kahapon pinost na namin, meron tayong mga kababayan na mag-asawa, 102 years old, saka 95 years old, nagpabakuna po sila. So okay naman po.
In contrast, hundreds of priority residents trooped to a mall in Parañaque City as the local government began rolling out Pfizer vaccines. The National Task Force Against COVID-19 expressed alarm over what it calls an obvious lack of social distancing, but said the LGU immediately addressed it. Parañaque City received 5,800 initial Pfizer doses for priority groups A1, A2, and A3.
Pero makikita po natin marami po nag-walk in. Ang priority po natin, yung nakatanggap po ng text mula po sa ating gobyerno.
The Philippines has so far administered over 2.9 million COVID vaccine doses in 2.5 months of inoculation. Government has said the Philippines is now second in ASEAN when it comes to vaccination rollout. But this chart shows that when the number of vaccinated people is computed as a percentage of the country's population, the Philippines' vaccination rollout is actually at the bottom two of the list. And Vietnam, which has the lowest number of people vaccinated, does not even need a massive vaccination program because it only has less than 5,000 total COVID-19 cases. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Supreme Court wraps up oral arguments on petitions challenging the constitutionality of the country's Anti-Terror Act. As Mike Navalio tells us, legal experts tapped by the court to resolve the issue offered different views on the contentious measure.
The court concludes the oral argument in these petitions. Adjourn the session.
10 months following the first petition challenging the constitutionality of the Anti-Terrorism Act before the Supreme Court, and after 9 hearings, the High Court on Monday ended oral arguments on a contentious law. Amicus Curiae, friends of the court, legal experts whose opinions the court had sought, share their views. Former Chief Justice Renato Puno recognized the difficulty of discussing terrorism when even the United Nations itself could not come up with a definition acceptable to its member states. But he saw how radical the approach has become under the Anti-Terrorism Act compared to other criminal laws.
The Anti-Terror Act has changed the legal approach of the government to check the particular crime of terrorism. Heretofore, our laws towards crime is essentially punitive, prosecute violations of our criminal laws and penalize the violators. The Anti-Terror Act's approach is more radical when the crime involved is terrorism. The government is allowed to take preventive measures to stop the violation from happening. And for this purpose, the government is given new tools such as detention and surveillance of suspects.
There's a need, Puno said, to balance individual liberties and national security.
The balance should not reduce individual rights into insignificance, for they are inherent to human dignity. Neither should the balance put an end to the security of the people who did not enter into a suicide pact when they ratified the Constitution. The ideal is for us to be both free and safe.
Puno said he submitted a position paper to the Supreme Court stating his views on the different provisions of the law. But former Associate Justice Francis Ardileza provided a categorical take.
I humbly submit that following this court's ruling in Southern Hemisphere Network versus the Anti-Terrorism Council, all 37 petitions should be dismissed.
Ardileza said none of the petitioners suffered direct injury that would entitle them to seek relief. That's because none of them, he said, was charged or designated as a terrorist. But on Monday, peace consultant Ray Casambre filed a manifestation before the Supreme Court about his inclusion in the Anti-Terrorism Council's list, designating him and 18 other alleged communist leaders as terrorists. It is not immediately clear if Ardileza was aware of the filing, but the former magistrate told justices the hierarchy of courts need to be respected, since only regional trial courts and the Court of Appeals can receive evidence and try factual issues.
Judges of the RTC and justices of the Court of Appeals are not only equipped to receive and assert the facts for this court, they also, in their own right, make constitutional law. I think it is time we start hearing them first by giving them the first crack at cases such as this.
He added, every law passed by Congress is covered by the presumption of constitutionality. The Supreme Court decided not to continue interpolating National Security Advisor Hermenes Esperon Jr., but he was asked to comment on petitioner's motion seeking to throw out his testimony during last Wednesday's hearing. In his testimony, Esperon showed two videos of CPP founder Jose Maria Sison, who supposedly named the organizations allied to the armed struggle. But Sison said the video was spliced, and he in fact clarified that legal organizations had nothing to do with the underground component of the National Democratic Front. Even magistrates have questions too, according to Chief Justice Alexander Gismundo, and Esperon is expected to address them in his comment. Both sides have 30 days to submit their memoranda.
The oral arguments may have ended, but deliberations among magistrates are just about to begin. How to settle an issue that has polarized certain segments of Philippine society that now lies in the hands of the magistrates? Mike Navallo, ABS-CBN News.
And that's Head Start today. We were supposed to talk to party list lawmaker Rodolfo Ordanez on his resolution seeking to help the fire-hit Philippine General Hospital. The congressman, according to his staff, was called to a meeting with House Speaker Lord Alan Velasco, along with other lawmakers in Congress. I'm Karen Davila. Thanks for watching. Stay informed and stay with ANC.
After the fact, we get to see things more clearly.
Do you stand by your vote, and are you proud of that vote?
Of course, you have to stand with what your decision is.
Is this something that the House should be proud of, rejecting the application for a new franchise by ABS-CBN?
Well, it's the decision of Congress.
Inside any specific after the journal. Fact, we know who's telling the truth.
Sana kung meron kayo mga crews dito.
Alam niyo naman yung nangyari, Governor, di ba? You were asking, sana may crew dyan. I suppose you were referring to ABS-CBN. Eh, hindi binigay yung franchise eh. So, naisara yung regional station. So, paano makakover yung nangyari dyan? What clinched the speakership
after the fact, for with Christian Esguerra. Weeknights at 8 p.m. only on ANC.
As the country continues to deal with the rise of COVID-19 cases, more volunteers come up with solutions to help flatten the curve.
Filipino architects and engineers